it's a DC to DC conversion. Basically, these are building blocks. We may be able to use this building blocks directly, or some modification we may have to do while integration. Okay. So right now we'll just study these building blocks, and maybe towards the end, depending upon the power level, when we integrate various blocks, we'll study the modification that we need to make in these building blocks. Okay. Basically, the entire DC to DC converters can be broadly classified into two groups: with transformer, without transformer. Okay. Again, remember, I'm using DC to DC conversion, DC to DC conversion, and they are classified into two groups: with transformer and without transformer. I don't know how the transformer can be used in DC to DC conversion. That question we will answer sometime later. Okay. But then, yes, we are using a transformer in DC to DC converter, or we are using an inductor in a DC to DC conversion. And the frequency, generally, depending upon the power, the frequency does change. Okay. Let's see, what is the effect of using this, or what is the effect of switching frequency on the size of the converter? Okay. So if I say the VA rating of the transformer is given by this equation, 4.44 F into phi into N. This is nothing but the voltage induced in the coil into the current. Okay. For a same VA rating, number of turns come down, number of turns reduces as the frequency increases. Okay. So therefore, as the frequency increases, N come down, but then as the frequency increases, if the core has a hysteresis loop, my core losses increases. Okay. So therefore, I may not be able to use the core that is used in 50 hertz conversion in high frequency power conversion. So in high frequency power conversion, I need to use a core which is having a very small hysteresis loop. Okay. Generally, a ferrite core is used. The problem with the ferrite core is it is very brittle. Okay, and the operating flux density is very low. It could be of the order of around 0.2 tesla. Of course, then now amorphous alloy cores are also available. B average is of the order of 1.1 tesla. Okay, so these are the two cores are popularly used in DC to DC conversion. Coming back to buck converter, maybe all of us know, I'll quickly cover this. The circuit configuration is given here. Switch S is switched at a very high frequency. Okay, LF, L is the filter inductor. Fortunately, it is written L here is the filter inductor. CF is the filter capacitor. V naught is assumed. I have to regulate the output voltage. I'll repeat. I have to regulate this output voltage. This voltage may be directly coming from the solar cell, and it could vary. Okay. Now, how do I analyze this circuit? Okay. Switch is on, turned on off at a very high frequency. Okay. It is on for D into T, where T is the switching frequency, D is the duty cycle, and it is off for 1 minus D into T. When the switch is on, the equivalent circuit looks something like this. The equivalent circuit of this buck converter looks something like this. Diode is reverse biased. Okay. I told you we need to regulate V naught, and in one switching cycle, I will assume that even this voltage remains constant. Okay. So under that condition, when the switch is on, voltage across L is VDC minus V naught. I'll repeat, when the switch is on, voltage across L is VDC minus V naught. Okay. I told you in one switching cycle, VDC is assumed to remain constant. V naught will remain constant because that has to be regulated. So therefore, VDC minus V naught is a constant. Okay. So voltage across the inductor is constant during this time, D into T. So if the voltage remains constant, inductor current will increase linearly. Okay. and at the output stage, okay, I need to apply KCL at this node. It is given by IL is equal to C dV naught by dt plus V naught by R. V naught by R, okay. The KCL at this node will give IL is equal to current flowing in resistor R or the load, that is V naught by R. It does not matter, output stage could be anything. I can have an inverter as well, but then I will represent that inverter feeding a load as a current source. See, I will repeat here, I have connected a resistor, okay. We can have an inverter feeding some other load as well. I will represent that inverter along with the load as a current source, which is equal to I naught. In this case, it is V naught by R. See, dV by dt is the capacitor current. So, when the switch is on, voltage across the inductor is VDC minus V naught. What happens, or what is the voltage when the switch is open? When the switch was closed, current flowing. This is the direction of current that is flowing through the inductor. We know that inductor current has to be continuous. When I open the switch, direction of current will still remain the same, and therefore it will flow through the diode D. Okay. So when the switch is open, voltage across the inductor is now is the output voltage V naught itself. But then, with respect to the negative DC bus, voltage across the inductor is now minus V naught. Minus V naught. Plus is here, negative of the output or negative terminal or the ground potential is the reference terminal is connected to this point. So, voltage across the inductor is now minus V naught. I told you V naught is regulated, supposed to remain constant. Therefore, voltage across the inductor is constant, current decreases linearly. The same voltage equation, sorry, current equation at this node, IL is equal to C dV by dt plus equal to. So, how do I determine the transfer function? I will use the condition that average voltage drop across the inductor at steady state should be 0. So, in other words, VDC minus V naught into dt, that is voltage across the inductor during T on, should be equal to V naught into 1 minus D into T. So, average voltage across the inductor is 0, this is a voltage condition. So, therefore, if I simplify, I will get V naught is equal to D into VDC, okay. Very popular anyway. Yeah, this is the average current. I will average, you can see dV by dt average for V naught by R at steady state. At steady state, average value of the current to the capacitor should be 0, otherwise capacitor voltage will change. I told you that V naught is regulated, so therefore this current has to be 0. So, IL average is equal to V naught average by R, okay. These are the various waveforms, okay. Voltage waveforms, so switch on, switch off, inductor current increases linearly, decreases linearly. How does the source current look like? IS, switch current. See, the moment I close the switch, whatever the current that is flowing through the diode and inductor now starts flowing through S. Okay. I have assumed a continuous conduction. I am saying continuous conduction in the sense current through inductor is continuous. Remember that, in other words, at any given time there is some finite current flowing through the inductor. So, the moment I turn on the switch, that current will start flowing through this switch. So, instantaneously the source current, sorry, or current flowing through the switch looks something like this. So, this is the inductor current, varies linearly. This part of the current source supplies, so this is the current waveform. So, if you see here, remember this is one of the limitations of this buck converter. Source current instantaneously has to change from 0 to whatever the current that is flowing through the inductor. In other words, even the source, even the device has to carry this current. When the switch is turned off, whatever the current that was flowing through the switch or whatever the current that is flowing through the inductor will start flowing through the diode. This is the diode current. So at this instant in the second cycle, switch is turned on again. So diode current instantaneously will become 0. Instantaneously will become 0 and this current, this cycle will repeat. And this is the voltage or voltage waveform across the capacitor V naught. By the way, see there is a flaw in our analysis. In one point I am saying that V naught should be regulated, V naught is supposed to remain constant, but then here I am showing capacitor voltage does change. Yes. Now you need to understand in what context I am saying that V naught will supposed to remain constant. For all practical purposes, I am assuming V naught will remain constant for all practical purposes. In other words, output voltage ripple has to be regulated within less than 1% or so. So I can assume that V naught will remain constant. Okay. But then there is some current when the switch is closed, some current will flow through the capacitor. Therefore, capacitor voltage will increase and during some time capacitor will discharge and therefore the capacitor voltage will fall. When does the capacitor charge and when does the capacitor discharge? This condition is given by the Kirchhoff's current law. So if I use KCL here, IL is equal to current flowing through the capacitor plus current flowing through the load. If I represent current load as a constant current source, I'll repeat, I'll assume that load is a current source having a constant magnitude. If the inductor current is, I'll repeat, if the inductor current is less, if the inductor current is less than the this current source, the remaining current capacitor supplies. If the inductor current is more than the value of I naught, the addition, the difference between these two currents will flow through the capacitor. Okay. So therefore, KCL will tell me whether the capacitor is charging or not. If IL is higher than I naught, C will charge. If IL is less than I naught, C will discharge. That's all. See, in this case, this is a dotted line shows the value of the current source or value of the current that is flowing through the load. This is the capacitor, this is the inductor current. In this period, inductor current is less than I naught. So the remaining current has to come from the capacitor. Okay. So therefore, capacitor is discharging, output voltage CV naught is reducing. Okay. In this zone, see in this period, inductor current is higher than the load current, the I naught. So the remaining current has to flow to the capacitor. So therefore, capacitor voltage will increase. So remember, just because you are turned on the switch here, it does not mean that capacitor will start charging. No, KCL will tell you whether the capacitor will charging or not, not the conduction state of the switch. Okay. Similarly here, just because you are turned off the switch does not mean that capacitor is discharging. Again, the KCL will tell you whether the capacitor is charging or discharging. You need to apply Kirchhoff's current law. So see here, switch is open in this period. Since the inductor current is higher than I naught, the remaining current is flowing to the capacitor and therefore is charging here. Now how do I choose the voltage and current rating of the devices? So what is the voltage rating of this diode? Voltage rating of the diode is nothing but the supply voltage itself here, VDC itself, or the whatever the maximum solar voltage, whatever. That happens when the switch is closed here. So all the voltage appears across the diode and diode has to block. And what is the voltage rating of the switch S? That I encourage you to find out. Draw these two equivalent circuits and find out what should be the voltage rating of the switch. This equivalent circuit will tell you the voltage rating of the switch. See here, the entire supply voltage comes across the switch. So therefore, voltage rating of the switch is determined by the supply voltage itself. This is the input output losses. Input output power condition. I'm assuming the ideal condition, no losses are zero. So this is the input power. VDC into IS should be equal to V naught into I naught, average values. So IS is D into I naught. By the way, this is the average current rating. So peak current rating you need to determine from this waveform. So what should be the current rating? See this IS has to flow through the device. At this point, device is turned off. Whereas I naught is, this is the average value of I naught. So you need to take, while choosing the current rating and voltage rating, you should be a bit extremely careful. Now, how do I choose the value of L and how do I choose the value of C? Value of C will determine the ripple in the output voltage, and value of L will determine the ripple in the current. See, now let us give an expression for the current ripple in the IL. So dl by dt is given by VDC minus V naught divided by L when the switch is closed. So therefore, I max is given by, of course, this is equation of this straight line, okay, with this I mean as the y axis intercept, I mean plus, so I can determine the value of I max is given by this equation. I max minus I mean will give the total ripple. This is when the switch is open, current falls linearly. This is the voltage. This equation will give you the rate of change of current, and therefore current ripple is given by where does the ripple is maximum. You find out, how do I find out dl is given by this. Now dl by this L maximum and d is equal to 0.5, and that maximum ripple is given by VDC by T divided by 4L. Now you put a limit on this. T is the switching frequency, you know the DC link, you know the supply voltage, and therefore you can calculate L. I will repeat, this is the maximum ripple that a designer has to select. T is the switching frequency, VDC is the supply voltage, in this case you can take an appropriate voltage, and that will give you the value of L. Now capacitor voltage ripple. So this is the variation of inductor current and this is the variation of capacitor current. I told you KCL will tell you whether the capacitor is charging or discharging. In this zone, delta T by 2, see, so this is entire period is delta T, this is delta T by 2. In delta T by 2, capacitor is discharging because I naught is less than, I naught is less than the inductor current. So capacitor has to supply that current. At this point, at t is equal to dt by 2, capacitor current is 0 because inductor current is equal to I naught, and beyond that, beyond dt by 2, inductor current increases, therefore capacitor is charging. So this is the capacitor current waveform, and this capacitor, if I know the capacitor waveform, I can draw the capacitor voltage waveform. Okay. IC is given by, this is a voltage, the current equation for the current flowing through the capacitor. IC is given by this equation. This is delta IL by 2, this is entire period is dt, this change is linear. So this is the equation for the capacitor current, and from dt to t, capacitor current is given by, now capacitor voltage is V naught max minus V naught min. So 1 over C, you integrate IC dt, therefore delta V naught is equal to 1 over C delta IL T by 8. This is the expression for delta V naught. Now you put a limit on delta V naught, okay, delta L you chose in the previous case. Yes, it is an iterative process because delta I L will see if you see this value here, inductor value will, the moment I choose L, delta I L gets fixed, but then here if you see delta I L will determine delta V naught as well. So you have to, may have to go back and forth iteratively and calculate the value of C and L to get the required ripple on output voltage and required ripple in inductor current. That's about the buck converter. Voltage and current ratings I can determine from by seeing the waveforms. The value of L and C I can determine by fixing the value of the current ripple and the voltage ripple. T corresponds to the switching frequency. So this what it is equal to 0.5 maximum. Notice I do not want to discuss about the discontinuous conduction, not very important. Maybe I will discuss the boost converter. Where do you want to use boost converter? Let us not discuss now. We will see sometime later integrating the various power electronic equipment. Right now we will just study the subgroups. The circuit topology for a boost converter is given by, is shown here. The switch is turned on off at a very high switching frequency. Close S. When I close S, DF gets reverse biased because, sorry, this diode gets reverse biased because output voltage appears across D naught, sorry, appears across D. So diode is reverse biased. In the input side, supply voltages or whatever the solar energy voltage appears across L. When the diode is off, capacitor is supplying power to the load, in other words capacitor is discharging, okay. So this is the equivalent circuit. Voltage across, voltage applied to the inductor is constant because of course it may change in real life, it will change, but then since the switch is turned on off at a very high frequency in one switching cycle, VDC is expected to remain constant, okay. So therefore in one switching cycle voltage across the inductor will remain constant, therefore current increases linearly. Capacitor is supplying power to the load, so capacitor will discharge, okay. See here V naught is expected, we are expected to regulate V naught, but then in this case what happens is capacitor is supplying power, so capacitor voltage will fall. So now you need to fix a limit on delta V naught and therefore and thereby calculate the value of C. So remember, in some applications or while deriving the transfer function, I have to assume that V naught will remain constant, and I have to change, I have to take this change in V naught into account while calculating the value of L and C. Okay, remember that. I will repeat, while calculating or while determining the transfer function, I will assume V naught will remain constant. But then when I am determining the value of C and L, I have to take the change in V naught and change in I L into account. Now open S. In this case, prior to opening the switch, switch was closed, current was flowing through the inductor. Inductor current has to be continuous. So therefore this inductor current starts flowing through, will flow through the capacitor and R. Now voltage applied to the inductor here, our voltage across the inductor is VDC minus V naught, VDC minus V naught, here it is VDC. When I close the switch, current flowing through the inductor increases, therefore when I open the switch, current flowing through the inductor should fall, only then I can have a steady state. What is the steady state? See, I will repeat. This is, I will take T is equal to T1, this is T is equal to T2. if the both the values of current at t is equal to t1 and t2 are same, then I can say that circuit has attained almost a steady state. Okay. Now this can happen only if current falls here, because when I close the switch, current increases here also, current increases. So that can happen only when voltage across the inductor is negative. Voltage across the inductor is negative, and voltage across the inductor can be negative only if V naught is higher than VDC. If V naught is higher than VDC, voltage across the inductor will be negative. So in other words, for steady state operation, V naught should be higher than VDC. I will repeat, for steady state operation, V naught should be higher than VDC. So hence the name boost converter. Hence the name boost converter. What am I doing after all? I am storing the energy in the inductor, transferring the capacitor. So therefore, capacitor voltage has to increase. So it will increase. Hence the name the boost converter. These are the voltage equations. They are very simple. You can, I am going to discuss them. If I equate them, average voltage across the inductor should be 0, VDC into D into T is equal to VDC minus V into VDC minus V naught into 1 minus D into T. If I equate, I will get this transfer function, VDC divided by 1 minus D. So for any value of D, V naught is higher than VDC. What happens to V naught as D tends to 1? As D tends to 1, V naught tends to infinity. See here, when D tends to 1, V naught tends to infinity. But then what is the reality? D tends to 1, it implies the switch is permanently closed, and this is the equivalent circuit. So in this case, when the switch is permanently closed, inductor is permanently connected across this DC supply, okay, and output capacitor is continuously supplying power to this load. So what will happen? Three things can happen. Inductor will get saturated. If inductor gets saturated, S switch can fail, inductor can fail, the source can fail, because if the source is saturated, current is limited by the internal resistance itself. But in this case, it happens to be ISC, the short circuit current of the solar panel. And if it is less than the current rating of S, nothing may happen. But at the output stage, what will happen? Output stage, capacitor will continuously discharge, and this voltage will tend to 0. So where is the flaw? In real life, I mean, if I analyze this circuit, it will tell me, or by inspection, if it tells me that V naught tends to 0 when D tends to 1, but the transfer function tells me when D tends to 1, V naught tends to infinity. So how can there be such a huge difference between an ideal case and a non-ideal case? If I just see the circuit here, V naught tends to 0. If I see the transfer function, V naught tends to infinity. What is the flaw? The flaw is that, how do we derive this transfer function? We derive the transfer function making certain assumptions. What are the assumptions? We assume that V naught and VDC are constant and ripple free. Okay. Can V naught be ripple free for high values of D? V naught cannot be ripple free for high values of D. Why? As D increases, capacitor is continuously supplying power to the load. So therefore, capacitor voltage has to change. So our assumptions are not valid for high values of D. For low values of D, they are valid. For high values of D, I can't take the ideal conditions, such as, see, I have represented this inductor, I assume that L is ideal. This is true for low values of D. For high values of D, I have to take all the non-idealities into account. I have to take the resistance also into account. Now, if I take that resistance into account or non-idealities into account, what sort of a transfer function will I get? See here, I have taken this R into account, and I will write the equation, same equation. Now, VDC is equal to R into IL plus L dI by dt. this is the KCL at the output stage, and again this is KVL and KCL. Using KVL and KCL I get these two equations, and if I simplify them now, taking the average values, average of this is 0, average of this is 0 at steady state, I will get this function. This is the transfer function taking the winding resistance of the inductor into account, winding resistance. Now see, if I put D is equal to 1, if I put D is equal to 1, V naught tends to 0. If I D tends to 1, even V naught tends to 0. Now if I substitute R is equal to 0, then there is nothing but an ideal case. I have a transfer function for an ideal boost, VDC divided by 1 minus D. I will repeat, see, I have just taken this R into account in a non-ideal case. If I equate it to 0, I will get a transfer function for ideal. This is the transfer function for non-ideal, when D tends to 0, V naught tends to 0. So if I plot both the voltage and functions, it looks something like this. This tends to infinity for ideal boost, and this is for non-ideal boost. When D tends to 1, output is equal to 0. For D is equal to 0, ratio is 1. So it increases for low values of D, reaches a peak and falls down. And this peak depends on, see here, I differentiated this equation and equated to 0, I get V naught max is equal to VDC by 2 divided by R by R. So this maximum value that I can get depends on the ratio of the load resistance to the inductor resistance. Smaller the resistance, higher is the value. Now how do I get this small, how do I reduce the value of R? I will show you two different inductors, okay, same value of L, and the technique that is used to reduce the winding, effective winding resistance, how we have tried to reduce this value of R. If I try to reduce the value of R, my V naught, the maximum voltage that I can get can be increased. Here lower the value of R, higher is the value of, but thumb rule is that the ratio we can get, a maximum ratio that we can get is 10, maximum 8 to 10. So if you want to boost the existing voltage by a factor 8 or so, you can use the conventional boost. Otherwise we have to really think of an alternative solution. What is that alternative solution? We will see sometime later. This is the filtering requirement, same, okay, I'll do. This is the source current waveform for a buck converter. I said the moment, as soon as in a buck converter, the moment you close the switch, see here, the moment I close this switch, whatever the current that was flowing, instantaneously it has to flow through the switch S or to the source here. So there is a step jump in the source current, okay. So the so called di by dt that is flowing through the source is really high, very high. So I may have to use a special filtering technique or special filters may be required at the input. Whereas what about for a boost converter? Boost converter is source current is, how do I represent this? See the equivalent circuit of the boost converter when the switch is on and switch is off. This inductor is always there in the circuit, always the same current. See here, the current increases linearly and current decreases linearly. Again I close the switch, again it starts increasing. So I can represent this source current input stage, this stage, as a current source. Yes, any electrical engineer will, when he sees this part, a DC voltage and an inductor, you can represent this by a current source. So I have almost excellent input characteristics. A current source, but then see the filter output stage, the filtering requirement. Here the capacitor is continuously discharging during when the switch is open, this capacitor is continuously discharging. Definitely, capacitor voltage will fall. See here in buck converter, since at any given time some current is flowing through the inductor, so ripple here for same current may be less compared to boost converter, because your capacitor has to continuously discharge, capacitor continuously discharging. This sort of equivalent circuit I do not get in buck converter. So, these are the various waveforms, okay. And using these waveforms, I need to calculate the value of L and C, ripple in V naught and ripple in I naught, neglect R, okay, and delta V naught to determine I, delta IL. I am neglecting the ripple in the output voltage to determine IL. This is the voltage equation. Simplify, solve, you will get this equation. So, delta IL is given by VDC by L into delta into T proportional to D. Similarly, now I calculate the ripple in V naught, for that I will neglect the ripple in IL, okay. This is the voltage equation, okay, and delta V naught is given by this equation. I will just show you, this is a capacitor current waveform continuously supplying. See here, when the switch is open, KCL will tell me, KCL will tell me when the capacitor is charging and discharging. Here, when the switch is open, all the capacitor, all the load current has to flow through the capacitor, it will discharge. Here, when the switch is open, KCL will tell me whether the capacitor is charging or not. If this inductor current is higher than I naught, capacitor will charge. If inductor current is less than I naught, capacitor will discharge. This is what I have shown here. Capacitor is discharging, and in this case for some time capacitor is charging. This is true only for certain conditions, otherwise you need to apply KCL and only from there you need to determine whether the capacitor is charging or not. This is the expression for V naught and delta IL, and suitably give the suitable values for delta V naught and delta IL and calculate the value of C and L. Third one is the buck boost. See, all these are quite popular. It does, okay. See the circuit modification. Close S, VDC applies, gets applied to L. At the output stage, capacitor is supplying power, something similar to boost, something similar to boost. Open S, whatever the current that is flowing through inductor will continue to flow through S, something similar to buck. But then when the switch is open, the equivalent circuit is not something similar to buck, but something similar to boost here. When close S, inductor is charging, similar to boost. Output is capacitor supplying power, similar to boost. When I open switch S, this is the voltage and current equation, same procedure that you need to follow, and equate it. Transfer function is given by VDC into D divided by 1 minus D. This is the transfer function. So, if for D is less than 0.5, V naught is less than VDC. When D is equal to 0.5, V naught is equal to VDC, and D is greater than 0.5, V naught is higher than VDC, okay. So, I can get all three values less, equal or more, but then only difference is, see the reference point. The capacitor output voltage, this terminal is negative with respect to this point. If I take this as the reference, capacitor voltage is negative with respect to that. So, this issue has to be taken into account while designing the solar. I will take up few questions. There is a very popular converter, Cook converter. Maybe I will start in the next class.
Yes, NIT Kurukshetra, go ahead with your question.
So, this is regarding your previous lecture. My question is that for IGBT, regarding SOA, this is different from MOSFET SOA, and if it is different, then why this difference is there?
No, 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 same. SOA is the same. Same SOA as MOS.
Yes, KJ Somaya, Mumbai.
So, normally when we go for a converter, the requirement is that output voltage should be controlled. When we go for any converter, DC to DC conversion, requirement is the output voltage at the load should be controlled according. So in converter, the output voltage has to be controlled depending upon the availability of the input DC voltage. Here, what exactly is the nature of the load? Because is it a voltage that we want to apply somewhere, or it is a voltage from a solar photovoltaic which we want to control? So the output load condition is not so clear.
No. See, depending upon your end use application. Now you may be charging the battery, or you may be converting this AC to DC. You can either charge the battery, or you may be feeding any other load. Doesn't matter. My input voltage, I said input voltage does change. VDC is does, I represent VDC, that VDC actually represent the solar voltage, does change as the insulation changes. But then in one switching cycle, it is expected to remain constant. See, my sincere request is, these are all building blocks. When we integrate, we will see what happens, whether DC to DC converter has to regulate this voltage, or whether the inverter has to regulate the voltage. We will see who will do this regulating, to whom this task is given, whether to DC to DC converter has to regulate, or whether inverter has to regulate. We will see when we integrate it. See, when I have to feed the power to the grid, looks like inverter may have to do the voltage regulation. See, the things do change. All these issues cannot be explained at this stage, because yesterday one student asked, how do I synchronize the inverter to the grid? See, this question may be answered maybe towards the end. So voltage regulation, who does? As of now, buck converter is doing, or boost converter is doing, or buck boost is doing. When we are feeding power to the grid, looks like this control may have to be taken over by the inverter. So as of now, yes, inverter, the buck boost or buck boost converter has to do it. When we integrate it, things may change, because see, this is an interfacing stage between solar panel and the inverter. I'll tell you, this is one block between solar panel and the inverter. This buck converter or this DC converter may have to just to extract the maximum power from the solar panel. That may be the task, that's all. Who has to regulate the DC link voltage, we will worry sometime later.
VIT Vellore, go ahead with your question.
Sir, in the case of this buck converter or boost, whatever it is, in the case of buck converter, sir, first, this when the switch is open, the capacitor and the inductor will come in parallel. They will act as a voltage source for the load. Am I right?
When the switch is open, the equivalent circuit is something like this. Okay. This is L. Yeah.
If the inductor value and the capacitor value is increased, we get a better regulation. But the problem is, the source should be able to provide
what?
Of current,
huh?
In a very short time to the capacitor. So for better regulation, it is not just the inductor and capacitor values, but the source ability to provide the power.
Now I agree. Now value of L, well is chosen such that, see, you have to fix the value of delta IL, the variation in the inductor current, ripple. That will determine the value of L. Capacitor value will determine the value of V naught, or the change in V naught. C is delta V naught, L is delta IL. Now it is expected that source is response to whatever the output wants. It is expected that.
Right. Thank you, sir.
NIT Warangal.
Yes, sir, I want to know the maximum ratings of IGBT that is presently available, sir. And one more thing, sir, do the switching frequency should also be considered while you are designing the DC-DC converter?
Yes, switching frequency depends on the power rating. Smaller the power rating, higher can be the switching frequency. Higher is the switching frequency. I told you, see, just now we have discussed three types of converters. As the voltage rating, as the, see, there is, we derived a transfer function V naught is equal to D into VDC, V naught is equal to VD, V naught VDC into 1 minus D, and third one is VDC into D divided by 1 minus D. I told you maximum ratio in this case I can get is 7 to 10. What do I need to do if this ratio is higher? Similarly, what happens as the power rating increases? Can I use this conventional topologies, or do I need to make any alternative changes? We will see in detail. As the power rating changes, the configurations will change. As the voltage ratio changes, we may have to change this. Oh, we may not be able to use these converters directly. So right now we discuss the converters without transformer. If there is a large voltage ratio, we may have to go in for converters using transformers. Again, transformers in DC to DC, not DC to AC. Yeah, right now we use only inductor and capacitor. If I want a higher ratio, you may have to use a transformer as well in DC to DC. All these issues, depending upon the issues like what could be the switching frequency, what is the power circuit configuration, depending upon power level, voltage level, we will discuss at the appropriate time. Okay? Maybe sometime in the next lecture, definitely I will take up, if I have a large voltage ratio, what do I need to do? Yes, we will see. So take for example, if the voltage, solar panel voltage is 24 volts, I want it to convert into 230 AC, RMS. Can I use this boost? I may not be able to use this boost directly. Something else we may have to do. What we have to do, we will see.
Manipal Institute, please go ahead with your question.
You are telling about this boost converter, whatever we have discussed in theory, VDC, input voltage limitation. If that is up to what voltage level this is applied, whether at the power transfer at watt level or kilowatt level or megawatt level.
What is the limitation there? What I told you was V naught is equal to VDC divided by 1 minus D. Okay, this is for ideal. Yeah, whatever. And this maximum ratio I can have, is of the order of 7 to 10. Maximum ratio V naught by VDC. V naught by VDC, maximum ratio I can have is of the order of 7 to 10, provided I design a very good inductor. Very good inductor in the sense it has a large Q factor. It has a very high Q factor. If I have, I may be able to get of the order of 7 to 10. How to get that good Q factor? I will show you the inductor maybe in the next class. I forgot to bring, I will bring it. It depends on R by R. R is the winding resistance of the wire that you are, winding resistance of the coil. Smaller the resistance, higher is the Q, quality factor. So it depends on the quality factor of the inductor. Higher the better. How to increase this? We will see. You may have to use a leads wire, not a just an ordinary wire conductor. If you use just an ordinary conductor to make an inductor, you may not be able to get a high Q, and you may not be able to get this factor itself. 7 to 10 may not be able to get this factor. If you use a leads wire, wherein you can get, it is possible to get high values of Q, you may be able to achieve this ratio, 7 to 10. It is a strong function of the quality factor of the inductor.
With this ratio for a higher power transmission, input voltage VDC only should be increased. For example, if it is in a kilowatt range, VDC, that means the solar power generation,
yeah,
to be connected in series, and we should add up to the voltage level VDC input to be higher to this boost converter. So 10 times it can make the amplification, that it can be applied in that way, the circuit.
No, my sincere suggestion to you
is applying only voltage level, say for example 220 volts, oh, VDC we could able to connect. For example, when power transfer, SPV to, as you say, the grid connection, kilowatt level or megawatt level power has to be transferred. Can we apply this principle of VDC increase? That means SPV connected in series so that you can have input VDC of 1000 volts and 10 times. So you can go up to the 1000 volts, and that way can we do in this type of circuits.
Sir,
got a limitations on the voltage.
Sir, be with this question for some time. We will discuss this when we discuss the grid connection. The things will change completely when we are doing grid connection, grid feeding. But I sincerely request you is be with this question. You ask this question when I am doing grid connection, what exactly we need to do, because most of the concepts may remain the same, circuit topologies and our school of thought might change, might. So let me not answer this question, what we have to do when it comes to grid feeding. I think I will answer this question when we do the grid feeding topic, sir, at that appropriate time. Please be with this question for some time.
Sir, since we are discussing about the high frequency switching, is it not required to consider the switching losses?
Yes, definitely, definitely. Whatever that you do in life, you have to pay a price. Okay. If you want to reduce the size of the power electronic converter, okay, I have to increase the switching frequency. Higher the switching frequency, smaller the value of L. Higher the switching frequency, higher will be the switching losses. Fortunately, there are techniques to minimize these losses, what is known as the soft switching techniques. The moment I use the soft switching techniques, complexity increases. So you remember, to reduce the size of the power electronic equipment, I have to increase the switching frequency. If I increase the switching frequency, my losses increases. Okay. So therefore, losses increase, my efficiency will come down, my heat sink requirement may increase. Fortunately, I said there are techniques where I can try to minimize these losses by using soft switching technique. The moment I use the soft switching technique, my complexity increases. So that's why I said whatever that you do in life, you have to pay a price. Switching losses will be there, that they can be minimized using soft switching. What are the soft switching technique? If the time permits, I will discuss towards the end. Right now, we are doing what is known as hard switching.
Sir, my question is, what is the role of the parasitic resistance connected in series with the inductor and capacitor?
No. Parasitic role, they are inherently present. They say, can I have an ideal inductor? I can't have an ideal inductor. The moment I take a conductor to make an inductor, there is resistance, rho L by A. Higher the value of resistance, smaller the value of Q quality factor, and therefore I may not be able to boost it to a higher value. This resistance, the moment I take a conductor to make an inductor, there is going to be resistance. Now the question is how to reduce this resistance. There are techniques. Maybe next class I will bring two inductors and I will show you how to reduce this value of R, thereby increasing the quality factor.
Good morning, sir. There is another question. So can we connect two converters in parallel, any DC-DC converters in parallel, and what are the issues behind that?
Yes, why not? In the sense, interlude buck, there are techniques. As the power rating increases, or you know, to reduce the current ripple flowing, there are techniques. Interlude buck, you may be knowing them. Two buck converters are connected in parallel. For a given switching frequency, the current ripple reduces significantly. Okay, the control issues, I don't know whether I'll be able to discuss them or not. You have asked that question. If time permits, I will discuss it sometime later. As of now, I have no plans of discussing interlude buck and all those issues. But then I am telling you, I can tell you the there is enough literature available. I can put it on the Moodle and you can refer interlude buck converter, all those converters are well established. Anything else? Thank you.